Hello students, looking at current affairs for 16th May, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these nine. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, rupees 1 lakh crore farm fund infrastructure fund announced and a new law for contract farming would be planned. So here we can see the third tranche of Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan economic stimulus package has been announced by Union Finance Minister and it has called for the long pending agriculture marketing reforms now. So what has been announced is there will be a central law enacted to permit barrier-free interstate trade of farm commodities and also ensure a legal framework to facilitate contract farming. Apart from plans to invest rupees 1.5 lakh crore to build farm gate infrastructure and support logistics needed for fish workers, livestock farmers, vegetable growers, etc. So we'll see in detail what is it all about. So first of all, 1 lakh crore has been provided for agriculture infrastructure fund. So this will be a 1 lakh crore fund which will be financed and managed by NABARD, National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development. And this will be used for financing as such, providing finances to primary agriculture cooperative societies, farmer producer organizations, agricultural entrepreneurs, startups to develop cold chain storage and other post-harvest management infrastructure at the farm gate as well as at aggregation points. So that is agriculture infrastructure fund of 1 lakh crores. Then also there are plans to strengthen infrastructure in food processing, fisheries, animal husbandry, horticulture. So remaining 50,000 crore is for that, which is here you can see 10,000 crore is for 2 lakh micro food processing enterprising who will be provided with technical support to reach FSSAI standard, food safety and security standard as such. And then there is 4,000 crore for National Medicinal Board. So this will be for herbal cultivation with special focus on 800 hectare corridor for medicinal plants on banks of Ganga. Then, so these are funding and also plans for reforms in agriculture are two main reforms. One is on Essential Commodities Act, which will be amended to deregulate the sale of 6 types of agricultural produce. So these include cereals, edible oils, oil seeds, pulses, onion and potatoes. So it is said by the Finance Minister, Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman, that Essential Commodities Act was enacted at a time of food scarcity. And she says now what is happening is farmers are producing, there is abundance of crops and this sometimes lead to issues because they want to export but the law does not allow it. So sometimes she says farmers suffer, sometimes consumers suffer too because you know commodities scarcity results in increase in prices too. So she says stock limits will not be imposed on these commodities now except in cases of national calamities or famine or in extraordinary surge in prices. And even when stock limit is there, that would not be for food processors and exporters. It will be only for farmers. So these are the reforms in Essential Commodities Act which have been announced. So this will be done. Essential Commodities Act would be amended, has been announced. And second is regarding attempting to reform agriculture market too, because presently farmers are allowed to sell only through the mandi system, but presently during lockdown mandis are closed. So now farmers would be allowed to sell outside this mandi system too. So contract farming has been allowed, so is proposed to be allowed as such. So you can see it will allow farmers to sell produce at attractive prices beyond the current mandi system, facilitating barrier-free interstate trade and e-trading too, online trading too. So e-NAM is also there in place. We had discussed this. So agriculture marketing actually is a state subject. So when questions were raised that this is a subject in the state list, how can central government have a law on contract farming? Finance Minister said that interstate trade in this is in the central list. So this we are talking of agriculture marketing interstate basis. They are going to frame a law. There will be a legal framework to oversee contract farming, which will be in place. So it will provide farmers, it is said, with assured sale prices and quantities, that how much quantity is required and at what price, even before the crop is sown. So contract can be there with prior players who will invest then in inputs and even technology for the agriculture sector. So several agricultural economists have actually welcomed the reforms. So these are have been long-standing demands, have been in discussions for the last 2 decades. So they have been implemented now, that has been appreciated, but questions are raised because there's no immediate support to help farmers survive the current crisis. These are reforms, long-term measures. What is the immediate support being provided is being questioned. again, this all funding is loans which would be provided. So you can see. This is a gist of what we just discussed. The next is lockdown likely to be extended till 30th May. So lockdown, the third extension which had been announced of the lockdown, it started first on 24th March. The lockdown is now proposed to be ending on 17th May, but now it is said a fourth lockdown would be there. That is called lockdown 4.0. Prime Minister Narendra Modi had already hinted at it. So this is likely to go on till May 30, with considerable relaxations in green and orange zones. So we have already discussed which are the green, orange and red zones. So here you can see these are the green zones. There are 319 green zones in the country. So these are districts with either zero confirmed cases till date or no confirmed case in the last 21 days. So that is the definition for green zones. Then red zones are taking into account total number of active cases, the doubling rate of confirmed cases and extent of testing and surveillance feedback. So that decides red zones, and then orange zones are those which are neither red nor green. So it is said five states have together more than 30% of their districts in red zones. And what is permitted, what is not in each of these zones is given here, you can see. So even in red zone, essential industrial activities has been allowed. Construction is allowed where labor is available on site. E-commerce companies for essential goods are allowed. Private offices at 33% strength is allowed. And even all types of agricultural activities. This is again the gist of what is allowed and not allowed in each of the zones. And then there are certain activities which are banned across India throughout lockdown 3.0. That is domestic and international air travel for passengers, though stranded Indians abroad had been brought back. That was different. Passenger movement by trains except those cleared by government. So Shramik specials had been announced for migrant workers. So that is there. Then interstate buses for public transport, except in few cases, metro, rail, schools, colleges, educational institutions, hospitality services, all remain closed, along with cinema halls, shopping malls, and all social, political, cultural, and religious gatherings. So we'll wait for the new rules now under lockdown 4.0. The next is India surpasses China's COVID-19 tally. So the number of cases of COVID-19 in India has surpassed China now. We have a total of 85,761 cases, including 53,219 active ones. So since May 8, we have been every day having 3,600 cases and over 100 deaths on an average being reported. So here you can see. So India has a doubling time of 13 days, which is similar to what we have in Brazil and Russia. While doubling time has significantly increased in Western countries, even in US it is high at 43.4. So doubling time means this is how quickly cases of COVID-19 are doubling in the country. So that is a concern. Then next is Azan ban in three UP districts overturned. So Allahabad High Court has allowed azan in three districts of Uttar Pradesh, Ghazipur, Hathras and Farukabad, where it was stopped by the district administration because of Home Ministry's lockdown rules. But the Allahabad High Court bench through video conference heard the case and said that azan can be recited by the muezzin, the azan reciter, from minarets of mosques by human voice without using any amplifying device, and such recitation cannot be hindered under the pretext of violation of guidelines for COVID-19. So azan can be recited has been announced by the in the order by the High Court. It is said under no circumstances sound amplifying devices can be permitted to be used between 10 p.m. and 6 a.m. late night. So there are azans, actually the four timings of the azan do not fall under this. It is azan to be given five times a day. And the only azan which falls in this is the morning azan, which is at around 5 a.m. So apart from that, so sound amplifying devices are not to be used then. And even the petitioner said that they did not want to use sound amplifying devices. They were talking of azan through human voice, which was also not being permitted on the pretext of lockdown. So that was that. So this has been overturned by the Allahabad High Court. Then next is monsoon will arrive on June 5, says Indian Meteorological Department. So Indian Meteorological Department, the official government department which forecasts monsoon, says monsoon will arrive late in the country in Kerala. So Kerala's normal date of onset of monsoon is 1st June, but IMD says it will arrive on 5th June. So there will be a delay. While a private forecaster, Skymet in the country, says that arrival of monsoon will be early. Means on 20th May itself, monsoon will arrive in Kerala. So both are differing by a week. And IMD's for model as such has an error margin of 4 days. And Skymet's error margin is of 2 days, means plus minus 4 days. Means if it says monsoon will arrive on June 5 and it comes on June 2 as such to 4 days. So June, then only, then also it is within the error margin. So that's how it is. And Skymet has a 2 day error margin. So we'll wait and see when monsoon arrives. Then next is Supreme Court relief for firms unable to pay full wages during lockdown. So Supreme Court has asked government not to resort to any kind of coercive action against private companies who have not paid their workers full wages during the lockdown. So this was actually Ministry of Home Affairs order on 29th March that directed all small and private enterprises, including, to pay full wages to their employees. So many of these are tottering on the brink of insolvency now due to lockdown. So implementing this Ministry of Home Affairs order may not be possible. And that's what the Supreme Court also highlighted. This is an omnibus order. There are several issues involved which need government reconsideration. So Solicitor General Tushar Mehta, representing the government, sought time to file a detailed response. So there were a number of petitions filed by several companies challenging the constitutional validity of this 29th March order. That all industries, shops, and commercial establishments, without exception, pay their workers without any deductions in the name of COVID-19. Then next is can't stop migrants from walking home, says Supreme Court. So Supreme Court said it could not be expected to stop migrants from taking the hard and for many life-threatening options of trekking thousands of miles to their villages amid the lockdown. So this it was a petition filed, but court said that it was on, the onus was on the government to draw migrants away from long walks home and wait for government to arrange interstate transport. So it says the government has to do it. What will the court do? But so court said it could not pass orders on applications based on news reports. States have to act. But the work of the judiciary is to order the states to act if there are concerns. So instead of passing any order, Supreme Court raised its hands. It says government has to do it. What should we do? But it's the Supreme Court's duty to ensure that work is done by the government. Then next is US envoy calls out COVID-19 related rhetoric in India. So US envoy for international religious freedom, Sam Brownback, called out COVID-19 related rhetoric and harassment in India, especially against Muslims. And as well as he praised Prime Minister Narendra Modi's message for unity that COVID-19 does not see any religion before it strikes. So there have been fake news reports, misinformation being shared via social media, which has been highlighted. Even US International Commission for Religious Freedom, which is an independent bipartisan commission set by the US Congress, that is US Parliament, it downgraded India's religious freedom rating to the lowest grade. And it was taking into consideration even the Citizenship Amendment Act and NRC issue, which was going on in India. So India has been classified as a country of particular concern. That was the recommendation given by to the Secretary of State. And finally, you have the news. Center borrows another $1 billion from World Bank for COVID-19 relief. So Center is taking another $1 billion loan from World Bank to support its COVID-19 relief measures. Already $1 billion has been approved by World Bank to support India's health sector in April 2020, and now in May, this is another $1 billion. And this money will be used for reforms in India's social security net, making it more integrated, portable, and focused on urban poor. So it will be helping in funding Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. So out of $1 billion, $750 million means 5,000 crore will be for Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. So this is fund loans being taken by the government. So this is a borrowing. Second phase means after the 750 million, remaining 250 million, second phase will be around 1,900 crore, which will be provided post July to fund additional cash and in-kind benefits based on local needs through state governments. So this will be for portable social protection delivery systems as such, too. Like we have one nation, one ration card scheme, etc. So that will be used. So this will be used for reforms. So it will be used, funding provided will also be used for reforms in India's social security net as well, apart from implementing the scheme. So this is the detail regarding Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana 2, which was announced by Prime Minister in March. So there was medical insurance for doctors, paramedics, and other medical staff announced, 50 lakh medical insurance. Then food security, additional 5 kg wheat or rice per person for 3 months was announced. 1 kg free dal per households for 3 months was announced. Free LPG for Ujjwala beneficiaries for 3 months. Then for cash in hand, PM Kisan, which provides cash to around 87 million farmers. So 2,000 rupees cash will be provided in 10 days. Increase in MGNREGS wages was announced from 182 rupees to 202 rupees. Then 500 per month would go to Jan Dhan account holders. And even expatriate to senior citizens, widows and disabled. Collateral free loans for women self-help groups. And for organized sector, announcements were to pro that government will contribute employee provident fund to companies with less than 100 workers. Contribution for both employer and employee would be there. And non-refundable advance of 75% of 3 months wage from provident fund account will be allowed. And for construction work also, workers also, the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana announced that states can use the 31,000 crore construction workers welfare fund for their welfare, and states can use the district mineral fund for medical activities. So these were the announcements under Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, which now will be funded through the World Bank loan. So that is it. Thank you.